jump in Mark chapter 2, where we left off last time we were in that book. And we're going to see Jesus encountering his religious opponents in this
passage.
And as he interacts with them and answers their objections, we will see some very important things about how God sees us. And it's important to learn these because it's very different from what you would assume is how Jesus sees you. And, at the same time, we will be learning about how Jesus views all the people out in the world who are lost. Who are steeped in sin, just controlled by sin. And it's important that we learn that. Because the reality of how Jesus views them is very different than how you would assume he views them. And our flesh and our religiousness goes against, in many ways, what Jesus would have us believe about. We pick up in verse 13 of Mark chapter 2.
And we
find that he went out again by the seashore, and all the people were coming to him, and he was teaching
them.
God wants everyone to know him. He wants everyone to hear his word. And throughout the time Jesus was doing ministry on this earth, he was teaching everyone who wanted to hear the word of God. And there were many who were willing. They were coming out to the seashore. And he was teaching them. That's what Jesus wanted to do. He wanted them to know God. A false religiousness says, I will come to know God if anybody does, and I will tell you what I want you to know. But Jesus was openly wanting the people, all of the people, to be able to know God. And while this is happening, Jesus does something that would surprise everyone. And something which would offend most people. He calls someone to be one of the disciples. Let's see what happens. We'll read verse 14, and then I'm going to explain some background as to why this is amazing. What
happens?
Tells us Jesus did this. As he passed by, he saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, sitting in the tax booth, and he said to him, "Follow me." That Levi, who was Matthew, got up and followed him.
Mai departe,
Gospel of Mark and the Gospel of Luke. He's called by his other name, Matthew, in the Gospel that Matthew later wrote. Same guy, though, in the same story here is told in all three of those books. Now, you may be wondering, why is this amazing? Jesus goes to the tax booth and finds there a man who believes in him. He says, come, follow me, be one of mine. Be one of the 12 that is going to be known to all the world as my representative. Take on the authority of someone who will serve on my behalf. Well, but he found him in a tax Now, you naturally might say, well, I don't want somebody who's taking taxes and fines. But it's worse than that. These tax collectors were illegitimately doing what they were doing. They were greedy or they wouldn't have had that job. And they were people who weren't unwilling to hurt everybody else for their own financial gain, or they wouldn't have had that job. In fact, they were willing to be known by everyone as a bad guy who takes money illegitimately in order to have that
job.
Because here's the system that the Roman oppressors of Israel had set up. Rome said, we want taxes. When people travel, they're going to pay a tax. When people have things, they're going to pay a tax. And we need people from among you that are willing to work for us doing
that.
And you collect the taxes. And collect as much extra as you want.
For your income.
Get rich at the expense of everybody else. You won't have to pay the taxes. You just collect them from everybody else. If we say they owe us 10, feel free to art charge them 25. And that's what they did. And the tax collectors were known to be sinful people you couldn't trust. They could not be a judge. They weren't trustworthy. If they witnessed something happen, they couldn't testify to it in court. Because the law assumed they would lie. And they couldn't even testify in court. They weren't allowed to go into the synagogue. So they couldn't take part in worship of God. And since they worked for Gentiles in this endeavor, them as unclean. Known to be that bad. You would say, obviously, Jesus will not make that person an apostle.
There's
no way that Jesus would want him. Jesus doesn't want people who are liars and thieves and swindlers. Saved by Jesus Christ, all of us needed the grace of God infinitely.
Noi toți cei care ne-am pus credința în Iisus și suntem mântuiți, cu toți am avut nevoie de harul lui Dumnezeu.
But some, their sins were more known by the world around them than for other people.
Pentru unii păcate lor erau mai mult cunoscute de alții decât pentru alții.
Think, yes, I'm saved, but I'm less worthy than people that didn't sin as bad as I
am.
I'm saved, but I should be still ashamed. There was a guy in Pennsylvania when I lived there. His name was Eric. He was a homosexual and he owned abortion clinics. That's what he did for a living. And in fact, he was famous for those things. Because while most abortionists kind of hide from others, even dance at the front of the abortion clinic, he did, and say, "I feel giddy. Let's kill some babies."
And
guy.
Un om rău.
And everybody knew.
Și toată lumea știa că era un om rău.
Even the people that thought abortion was okay wanted him to just
chiar și oamenii din clinica lui care făceau abortul doreau ca el să tacă din gură, nu mai vorbi, nu mai spune ce facem noi aici.
One day, a Christian man named Steve had the word Spirit speak to him.
Un Christian, un Christian, a auzit pe Domnul, a
auzit. He said, go find that guy. And ask him about the plate of blue pills.
Și întreabă despre fărturia cu pastiluțele albastre.
Have you heard that from God?
Dacă tu ai auzit așa ceva de la Dumnezeu,
it'd be kind of scary, I guess.
And
probably say, Lord, I really, 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 really need to know this is you before I walk up to that guy.
Probabil că îi spune, Doamne, eu vreau să știu cu siguranță, dar 100% că, într-adevăr, tu ești acela care mi-ai spus despre această facultate cu pasele albaste înainte să mă duc la omul ăsta.
This homosexual who kills babies and is proud of both.
Pentru că acest homosexual care omoară copilași și care este mândru de ceea ce face.
And ask him what sounds to me like a loony question.
Să mă duc la el și să-i pun o întrebare care mi se pare de
spune. You're going to have to persuade me, Lord.
Doamne, tu trebuie să mă convingi că este într-adevăr lucrul pe care trebuie să fac.
Well, Steve was scared, but he did believe the Lord was telling him.
Lui Steve era frică, însă el a crezut într-adevăr acest cuvinte al lui Dumnezeu.
He went to the abortion clinic and found him.
Așa că s-a dus la această clinică, ce făcea abortul, și l-a găsit.
He had him, Eric said to him some profanities and then was going to walk away from it.
Eric a venit, i-a spus câteva înjurături și se pregătea să plece.
And Steve said, Eric, the Lord wants me to ask you about the plate of blue pills.
Și Steve i-a zis, Eric, Domnul vrea să te întreb despre farfuriuța cu pastile albastre.
And Eric stopped. And looked back at him. Is there any way that he could have known about that unless God told
him?
There wasn't any way. It turned out, though, that Eric was proud but not happy. And the night before, he was wanting to kill himself. He is alone in his home and poured out a whole bottle of sleeping pills on a plate. And stared at them for hours, trying to work up the courage to swallow them all and die.
Timp de ore întreg s-a holbat la farfuriță la câine cu pastile, gândindu-se, eu văd unde-și curaj să ia acele pastile și să moară. Dar nu.
But then the next day,
dar
din
ziua
următoare, someone walks up.
Și ziua care cineva vine la
el. Și says, Eric, the Lord wants me to ask you about the plate of blue pills.
Eric, Domnul vrea să te întreb despre farfuria cu pastile albastre.
He walked him into the abortion. Babies were being killed at that
time.
And he gave them the gospel. And Eric believed. And he was saved. Some of God's people were happy about it. The louder ones were not.
Dar cei mai gălăgioși nu erau.
And lots of fights were happening among Christians in that area.
Și în acea zonă au început să aibă o grămadă de certuri între creștini.
Because a lot of them were thinking, how dare that man want to come into the church now and say he's saved?
Și că nu spuneau, cum îndrăznește acel om să-și dorească să vină în biserică să susține că e mântuit.
He even admits he's still tempted toward homosexuality.
El chiar încă recunoaște că încă mai
somebody that bad, that man's going to do something more to earn it. That it does tell us is this. Verse 15, and it happened that Jesus was reclining in his house at the table, Matthew's house, Levi's house. And many tax collectors and sinners were dining with Jesus and his disciples. For there were many of them, and they were following him. So, Jesus tells Levi, the tax collector, come follow me. And Levi tells all of his rich friends, the only friends he's got, Jesus accepts us.
Iisus ne acceptă, ne primește.
I'm going to hold the banquet in his honor.
Și în cinstea lui Iisus, eu voi da un mare cinstit.
Come on over.
Haideți și voi.
This is a great event.
Este un eveniment uimitor.
But what this verse 15 has told us is something for us to read and celebrate.
Versetul 15. Ceea ce citim în versetul 15 este un motiv pentru noi să-l citim și să-l sărbătorim.
This is amazing that that happened. This is more amazing than it was when Jesus was able to say to a lame man, get up and walk in
path.
It is more amazing that God in the flesh, the Holy One of
Israel,
goes to the house of tax collectors and sinners and accepts them by having a meal with them.
Merge în casa acestor păcătoși, acestor famiși și acceptă să mănânce împreună cu ei.
Others wouldn't do that.
Alții n-ar face asta.
But a holy God,
un Dumnezeu sfânt,
does that.
O face.
And he did it knowing that people won't know about it.
Și Iisus a făcut lucrul acesta știind că oamenilor nu trebuie să facă acest lucru.
Verse 16.
Versetul 16.
When the scribes of the Pharisees saw that he was eating with the sinners and tax collectors, they said to his disciples, why is he eating and drinking with tax collectors and sinners? They're so disgusted with what Jesus has done. So disgusted, in fact, that they don't even tell him about it. You know when people get upset with something? If you did something mildly offensive right now in the room, somebody might turn to you and say, hey, what are you doing? But if you did something that got them really offended, they'd go to somebody else and say, did you see what he just did? People that are really irate, upset, they go talk. them and for us. Verse 17, hearing this, Jesus said to them, it is not those who are healthy that need a physician, but those who are sick. I did not come to call the righteous. The sick need the doctor. I'm the doctor.
Eu sunt doctor.
The sick are the ones that need me.
Cei bolnavi au nevoie de mine.
And I didn't come here for righteous people.
Și eu n-am venit aici pentru cei drepți.
Because what was true in what he said then is true now in the church age working through us.
Pentru că ceea ce era adevărat atunci când a spus Iisus este adevărat și astăzi pentru noi.
He says, I did not come to call the righteous.
Eu nu am venit pentru cei drepți.
He says that because we all think, who is Jesus?
Și a spus asta pentru că noi toți gândim, dar pe cine dorește?
The righteous. And when we're thinking that, we might even preach that. Stop sinning and come to believe in Jesus. Stop smoking and come to believe in Jesus. Stop drinking and come to believe in Jesus. Stop cussing and come to believe in Jesus. Stop, well, whatever it is you do that I don't like and come to believe in
Jesus.
Because Jesus wants righteous people. And righteous people are people who don't do things that I don't like. Who is righteous, Jesus won't let them be a Christian. Well, Jesus would let anybody be a Christian. But he understands something that we need to understand. As the Bible says in more than one other place, there is no one righteous, no, not one. Saying, I didn't come to call righteous ones. If I did, there'd be no one for me to call but myself. To fulfill God's righteousness, Jesus says, is a job I'm going to have. I'm a sinner too, but I just want you to be clear, I'm not quoting Jesus anymore. He was saying, all of them, all of you are sinners. Now, he doesn't deny tax collectors and sinners are bad. Because God doesn't excuse sinners by saying, no big deal that you did these things. He calls sinners, saying, come to me. Be saved by faith in me. And I will clean you. Pharisees thought they were righteous.
Acești farisei credeau că Iisus era righteous.
So what did they hear when he said
this? Ce-au auzit când Iisus ne-a spus așa?
They heard, I didn't come to call you, I came to call the tax collectors.
Și ei au auzit așa, n-am venit să vă chem pe voi, ci am venit să chem pe colectorii de taxe și pe păcătoși.
Now Jesus did want to save the Pharisees too.
Bineînțeles că Iisus dorea să-i mântuiască și pe farisei.
But he knew he couldn't unless they admitted they were unrighteous. When they use the terms tax collectors and sinners, they very foolishly weren't including themselves in that group. They thought sinners was in some other group of people. And if we're thinking like Pharisees, we'll think that too. And we get in a mindset that Jesus can't use us. Because Jesus wants ones that know they're sinners. You remember the parable he tells later about a tax collector and the Pharisee. He said the Pharisee goes into the temple. Says, Lord, thank you that I'm not like that tax collector. I fast twice a week. Because the Pharisee's way was to fast during daylight hours every Monday and Thursday. And I give and I do these things. And as I stand before God, I'm thankful that I'm righteous. And the tax collector, Jesus said, wouldn't even lift his eyes up to heaven and look for him. But he would just beat his chest. This, by the way, was a symbol that means I'm at fault.
The
Gospels tell us that many of the people that watched Jesus die walked away beating their chests.
Because
they were realizing he wasn't at fault. As he died, they realized
started to have the same thing.
Well, Jesus said in that parable, it was the tax collector who went back to his home justified the law. Because all he said was, I'm at fault. Lord, be merciful to me, a
sinner.
That's how Jesus used it. So, the first thing is, we wanted a lesson in how God sees us. And this is especially for Christians who think about themselves, I'm a worse sinner than others are. Who think others are going to look at me and say, that's an unworthy. If that's how you feel in your Christian, listen to this. Jesus is not ashamed of you. He is not embarrassed to save you and make you his child. He does not agree with those who reject you for not being their
standard.
They were trying to mock Jesus for eating with these people.
Farisei încercau să-l bajoc
here because I'm the Savior. And I came to call them to my salvation and eternal
life.
That's why Jesus would spend the next few years walking around with Matthew the tax collector. He split them into pairs of two, groups of two later, and sent them out to preach on his behalf. And he was happy to do that. Whatever your past was, he's happy to have you. Well, legalism doesn't go away when it's refuted.
Legalismul, din păcate, nu dispare atunci când este certat.
It keeps happening.
Ci continuă să
se întâmple.
Chiar și atunci, după ce a fost mustrat.
Verse 18, the encounter continues.
Și această întâlnire continuă și în versetul 18.
John's disciples and the Pharisees were fasting. Now, that's weird right there. That part.
Ucenicii lui Ioan și al fariseilor obișnuiau să postească.
This is John the Baptist. This is people, his disciples, who were believing that the Messiah was bringing
salvation.
And they're together now in what they're doing with the Pharisees. They went out and watched these other people being baptized by John. John called the Pharisees a brood of vipers. Told them to repent. They didn't. Now the disciples of John are looking at some of the legalism of the Pharisees. One day of atonement a year. One day that the Jews were told to fast for that day. And to show sorrow for their sin. And God would provide a covering for
them.
One day a year. The Pharisees well, let's do it 104 days. One day a year is pleasing to God.
Well,
just imagine how good we are if we do it 103 extra days. Not only do they include tax collectors and sinners, they get together for a feast with Jesus.
In
disciples that you seem to think are holy enough, they don't even do the fasting.
Iisuse, unde ucenicii tăi, despre care tu crezi că sunt mai sfinți decât noi, cum de ei nu postesc ca și noi?
Now, of course, in that context they're talking about, fasting is fasting to show sorrow. You, it's wrong for you to ever fast. There can be good reasons to fast. And you can do that. But Jesus is talking about the kind of fasting they're asking. A fasting of sorrow and hoping that will make God. About the bridegroom and Israel, the bride.
Toate pasajele din Vechiul Testament care vorbesc despre mirele și mireasa fiind Israel.
They're saying God is the bride.
Spune aici Dumnezeu. Ei spun Dumnezeu este mireasa.
God is the bridegroom. Sorry, guys.
Dumnezeu este mirele.
They're saying God is the bridegroom and Israel is the bride.
Și Israel este mireasa.
And yet Jesus comes, he says, that's me. In other words, I, God, am with them. They don't fast to get my attention. They don't mourn and long for my coming. I'm here. That's something for them. Ceremony and then taken away from each other.
La o nuntă nu stau așa lucrurile. Mirele și mireasa sunt împreună pentru acea săptămână, acea ceremonie și apoi mirele este luat.
That's not how weddings happen.
Nu așa, nu?
Jesus is saying, that's how this wedding's going to happen.
Așa va sta mirele cu această nuntă.
I'm going to be taken away.
You will be luat.
And then the bride,
apoi mireasa,
in the world,
în lume,
is going to be waiting. Then there will be times of
fasting.
So this is a different kind of thing. The marriage supper of the Lamb is a future event that we will experience. two closing verses for today, Jesus teaches us about the difference between his way of doing things and the Pharisees' way of doing
things. Și în ultimele două versete de astăzi, Iisus ne învață câteva lucruri despre modul lui de a acționa și modul fariseilor.
He does it with these illustrations.
Și o face folosind aceste ilustrații.
The first one, 21, no one sews a patch of unshrunk cloth on an old garment. Otherwise, the patch pulls away from it, the new from the old, and the worse tear results. I'm a new Savior that has come. And I'm not going to be just a patch on the old clothing. They could have put on someone trying to patch them up to make them look better. And it gets torn off. And the hole in them is bigger. People trying to follow you, Pharisees, they don't wind up better off, they wind up worse. Not what I came to do. Then verse 22. This one shows what he does do for us instead of what he does. It says, no one puts new wine into old wineskins. Otherwise, the wine will burst the skins, and the wine is lost in the skins as well. But one puts new wine into fresh wineskins. Somebody once gave us a jug of grape juice to use for communion in the church.
Cineva odată ne-a dat un bidon de must pentru a folosi la cină.
And it had been sitting in that jug. It was actually like one of these water bottles that seal that had been filled.
El a pus într-un bidon de apă.
Like a 10-liter. And it had been sitting in there
for a while.
And it hadn't been pasteurized. And so it turned out that the grape juice had fermented inside. Now that fermentation causes great force from the bubbling in there. And so it was new wine is what it was. It had fermented. And I went to open it. And I unscrewed the cap. And the force of it was so strong
that
the plastic cap flew against my hand. Made a loud bang. It hit me so hard that it bruised my hand. It hurt really bad. And covered me with wine. Because of the force of that that had been held in. In this day and age that we're talking about here, they would ferment the wine in wineskins that held on. So in order to carry the wine to wherever they were going to serve. And if it was new wineskins, then as it fermented and that force was there, the skins would stretch. And they would hold it, and there would be no problem.
Okay.
because the new wine was forming a new wineskin. But if they took wineskins that had already been used for that before, and they'd already been stretched to their maximum, and they filled those with the new wine, like Levi, Matthew, one's like the Pharisees, one's like all of us here. I'm trying to put my spirit into these ones. They're old wineskins. They can't hold me and carry me to the world to serve. Songwriter when I was a little kid. He died young in his 20s in a plane crash. He lived a very short time as a Christian. He had been one of the hippies of that day, the people that dropped of society to just celebrate drugs and immorality and live on the streets.
Era unul dintre hipioții din acea perioadă a vremii. Pur și simplu s-a lăsat de toate lucrurile doar ca să se împăturească drogurile, imoralitatea și...
And then he came to know Jesus.
Apoi, Jesus.
He stopped living in a hippie commune,
a
got married and had a family. Everybody, if you want. want to pay something for it, you can, but then you're not asked. If you want my records, they're free to you. At my cost, I'll pay
you.
If you have a lot of extra money you want to give, you already have it. It will fund other people getting records. But no questions asked. If you want it for free, it's yours. And he started to have a movement of Christians who knew who he was. The abortions were starting to happen at that time period. He is when his wife were broken hearted over. So many babies were dying, and so many women's lives were being destroyed. And if they would try to bring these pregnant out of wedlock girls into the church would say, well, hold on a minute. That could cause our daughters to start sleeping around and getting
pregnant.
And they did what they did. It's not our responsibility to help. And so he and his wife invented a new kind of ministry that hadn't existed before. A pregnancy help ministry. That when women and girls who were being pressured to abort would come, they would get help with everything they needed. And they would be given the gospel of Jesus Christ so that they could be saved. There are actually thousands of those ministries. In every community I have ever known of, they have at least one. This man who was being mostly rejected by the church and his wife knew that. Because at the time he was living, most of the church looked at him and the people he was ministering to as people unworthy. And so some of his music would be legalistic and self-condemning. And he wound up dying in a plane crash. Well, actually, it was his fault. It wasn't wise what he did, and it resulted in his home going to heaven. But very shortly before he died, he finally completely got it, what it's like to be saved by Jesus. And he wrote a song that didn't have any of that legalism in it. To all of us, showing us that we don't earn our way, but that he completely makes our way for
us.
And that even if others reject us, Jesus receives sinners and cleanses them completely. And he wants to be with us. And he is not embarrassed to have us. No matter what we did in our lives, no matter what we're known for having done wrong, no matter what we look like, child, my child, why are you striving? You can't add one thing to what's been done for you. I did it all while I was dying. Rest in your faith and my peace will come to you. And when I hear your praises, stones, I want to rain upon you with blessings that will fill your heart. I see no stain upon you. Because you are my child. And you know me. To me, you're only holy. Nothing that you've done remains, only what you do for me. That's the judgment seat of Christ that he was looking forward to and we can do. None of our sins will be judged that day. They were judged on the cross. The only thing we're judged on is that which we do for him. I would say that's going to be a real good day for
Ephraim.
It can be for us. And that closes our message with that thought. And then we'll sing this song of hope.